Hi, welcome back to the channel. My name is Molly and today at Live UTI Free, we're chatting with Dr. Elizabeth Kavaler about her approach to recurrent and chronic UTI. If you're new to our channel, be sure to check out the description below as we've linked to other resources that you might find helpful. If you enjoy these videos, think they're important and want to support what we do, be sure to hit subscribe and tick the bell so you get notified when we post new videos. And other than that, we hope these videos provide the insights you need to take the next step on your UTI recovery journey. So today on our Clinician Insights series, we're talking with Dr. Elizabeth Kavaler. Welcome and thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. So firstly, can you tell our community a bit about yourself, including where you're based and what you do?
Okay, yes. So I am a urologist. I was trained as a urologist, and I have a special focus on female pelvic medicine, which includes recurrent urinary tract infections. I'm board certified both as a urologist and in urogynecology. My practice is in Midtown Manhattan. I opened it 8 years ago. It's a private practice, and it's across the street from Rockefeller Center. And I opened it with the vision of having a practice that would make patients feel comfortable and safe, and we can manage a lot of the major concerns that they have, especially as it relates to urinary tract infections.
Amazing. So what sort of patients do you generally see?
So I see all sorts of urologic issues. I see both men and women. And on the female side, one of the major areas of focus is recurrent urinary tract infections, which I see because as a woman urologist, that's the sort of patient that is sort of seeks us out and seeks me out as a female provider. And so my practice sort of naturally evolved into focusing a lot on recurrent urinary tract infections, which I think a lot of providers finds a little bit challenging and not always so pleasant to treat. But we have sort of built our practice around this patient population to help them because A, it's an unserved population of women, and because it's the focus of what I do as a female urologist.
Okay, so what is your typical approach to diagnosis when you see a new patient who experiences recurrent urinary symptoms?
Most of the women that I see have been through a lot of trauma as it relates to these infections. They've had many infections, they've been to many different providers, urgent cares, emergency rooms, primary care doctors, they've seen gynecologists, and by the time they come to see me, they've often been extremely frustrated and they're very emotional about this situation that they're in. And so the first thing I do is listen to them. I listen to the story that they present with. And so I think it's very important from a therapeutic standpoint that they be able to tell their story. I also think it helps them feel heard. And then when I'm able to provide them with what I think should be done, they're more willing to accept it because I've listened to them and I've heard their story. Of course, the stories are very similar, and most women who I see have the same story. And every one of them thinks they're the only one who has this experience. And I say, and I hear this all the time, all day. And you're like, really? I thought I was the only one. And it's like, no, you are definitely not the only one. So once I hear what is happening, I ask questions relating to the condition that they're experiencing, just in general, their health habits, sexual habits, the things that will pertain to urinary tract infections. I often provide some sonograms so that we do non-invasive testing looking at their kidneys and their bladders, ovaries, uterus. Most patients are very concerned about how the infections and the antibiotics that they've been on have affected their organs. And they want to know, like, is there some kind of pathology that we're missing, or is there some kind of consequence of all the treatments that I've gotten? And so I can give them the reassurance that they, in fact, have very healthy organs and nothing is being impacted in a negative way.
I think that's a really nice point about the patients being listened and heard to, because I feel like in a lot of instances, they don't know where to go. So being listened to, that's a really great point. And patients knowing that they're not the only one that experiences this, and there's a lot of other people in the same situation.
Right, right.
Yeah. Okay, so It would be great to learn more about your approach to UTI testing and how you've implemented your own lab for this process. Can you tell us a little bit about this?
Yes. So once I started doing more and more of this, I realized that one of the challenges we have is that we don't have great testing. So in many cases, patients will be seen somewhere where there's no follow-up. They don't get their test results. The tests get lost. The lab data doesn't make sense. A culture isn't done, just a urine analysis. And it's all over the place. And it's really hard to get a good sense of what we're doing, what we're treating, and how we're treating it without having some kind of data that will help us. And so we decided that we were going to open a PCR lab in our office. And a PCR lab is different than a regular, what we call reference lab, where a culture is done. So when a urine is left in the office, it can be plated and the bacteria are grown and sensitivities can be attested with various types of antibiotic dips. And that'll take two days, three days, four days, depending on the lab. But there's a lot of processing that's involved, which means that the specimen has to get to the lab, it has to be put at the right temperature, it has to be properly handled, and it has to be properly plated. And there's a lot of error potentially within that process, especially now with so many specimens being processed because of viral issues and all the stuff that's going on now with COVID and the flu. So we opened a lab where two things we've kind of overcome. One is the quote unquote chain of custody. It goes from the bathroom and it goes 2 feet into our lab. So we know the specimen is being properly handled. It belongs to the patient who's left it, and it's getting into the lab as we want it to. And secondly, we can get results within 6 hours because it's a PCR lab. It actually takes about 3 or 4 hours to run it, but by the time we get all our specimens together, the patient leaves it in the morning, by 4:30 in the afternoon, we'll know which organisms are involved, we'll know which antibiotic options are available. And so patients are going to get rapid results that are reliable that they can then, or we can use to treat appropriately, so smaller amounts of medication are needed to get rid of the symptoms.
Wow, so that's the same day turnaround. That's really quick for patients, especially if they're in pain, and to know what antibiotics to take.
Right. That's right. And so what they'll do is if they drop off a specimen, they're really miserable, we'll give them an azo or over-the-counter medication. We can give them one antibiotic pill that we have here just to see, get things going. But then later in the day when they're ready for their second pill, because all these antibiotics are twice a day, we won't have to give them something that's incorrect. So one we gave in the morning is still the right one. We've only lost one, one antibiotic pill has been sacrificed, but it's not 4 or 5 days of having been on something that's going to be completely ineffective.
So in your experience, what are some of the common difficulties or obstacles that those living with recurrent or chronic UTI face?
So I think that one of the main obstacles is just being taken seriously for patients to recognize when they have something, they have something. If they've gotten infections, their whole adult life since they're, 16, 17, 18 years old, and they go into a facility to get tested, a lot of times doctors will be like, oh, well, the urine doesn't show anything, so you don't have an infection. And they do, and they know they do, but then they wonder, maybe they don't. Or after a series of infections, the doctors are like, well, maybe you don't have infections, because they get frustrated. Physicians, right, and the nurse practitioners and the PAs managing patients are frustrated. So they blame the patient. Then the patient starts to think, well, maybe I don't really have one, and they second guess themselves. And they're sort of in this whole, alternate universe of feeling like they have something that they know they have, but they're not being validated, and so they're not taking antibiotics. And so the first thing I like to tell patients, especially after they tell me this whole saga, is like, if you know you have something, you pretty much have it. And if the doctor tells you you don't, they're wrong. You're not wrong. If the culture says that it's negative and you have symptoms, there's something wrong with that culture. You're the one that knows, because you've been through this so much. The first one is just giving patients the sense of empowerment to know that they have what they have. And then the second is there's a lot of false information about hygiene and prevention and sexual practices. And there's a certain blame that goes on to patients who, all of us are like pretty similar in our habits and our practices. It's nothing to do with that. And then the third challenge is for patients to have access to the care they need so that when they have symptoms, they can actually get resolution quickly so that they're not on more medication than they need and they're not suffering needlessly.
I think that's a really great point, especially when you spoke about patients having the power and knowing that they know their own body. we have a lot of patients in our community that come to us because they've been told that the test is negative and so that they don't have UTIs and so they don't have any symptoms, when in fact it's almost empowering the patient to know that if you have symptoms, you know when you have a UTI or you know when you have symptoms.
Right.
Yeah, definitely. So typically, how long can a patient expect to be in treatment?
So the goal of our practice is for patients to have management that they can handle on their own, and they're not dependent on us to treat them or to provide, you know, medications or intervention, that they know what works for them. And there's a whole spectrum of options for patients to treat. At the most sort of sophisticated end would be antibiotics, right? That's what is available that I can provide patients. But then there are all kinds of over-the-counter things that they can use. And that's all at their disposal. And everybody who gets these infections goes online and they read about these products. And that's up to them if they want to use them. If they have symptoms and they want to use cranberry or one of the other products that's out there, or D-mannose, they can do that. What I can offer them is ways of using antibiotics that will be effective and safe for them, and also to provide them with those antibiotics. But I have no problem if they want to use alternate medicines or herbal medicines or naturopathic products. My role is, what happens if none of that is working? What else is there? And that's where I come in.
So do patients get given a treatment plan? Do they have a plan on how long they're going to be on the treatment for?
So there are three ways that we manage these. And they're with antibiotics. There are three methods of managing urinary tract infections with antibiotics, and it depends on where a patient is and sort of the whole experience of infections. The first one is self-medication, where an antibiotic is prescribed and they have it available and they can medicate themselves when they feel the symptoms have started, and they take whatever antibiotic it is, of which there are many options. It's twice a day for a maximum of 3 days. So the quicker they get the antibiotic on board, the quicker they feel better, the less medication they have to take. Mm-hmm. So the goal of self-medication is to have control and to be able to take less medication to get resolution much more quickly, so they're not exposed to too much medication and they're not calling, right? They have all their medicine available. They deal with it on their own. I see those patients once a year. We review how they're doing, make sure they have medication on hand. Sometimes we switch it because one antibiotic doesn't work as well as it used to. We switch to another one once a year. The second group are the ones that go on what's called the post-coital pill, which is where they take a half dose of an antibiotic, one full pill but a half dose. Again, many options are available. They can take it before or after intercourse if they feel that their symptoms are related to sexual activity. And those patients, I'll give them their medication, and if they feel either that they're getting an infection without having intercourse, or if they feel that they're ready to stop that and do it for 6 months, and they feel like, I think I'm sort of better now, I would like to not have to do that anymore, I'll see them at that point, and then we'll put them on the self-medication program. And that's up to the patient to decide when she's ready to do that. And the last group are the group that go on the daily low-dose antibiotic, which is a half of a single dose medication every single night for a given period of time. And that's for women who get so many infections, they don't even know if they have one anymore. So we'll put them on that. And I usually start with a 6 week course. I have them come back in 6 weeks and see where they are. Some are ready to come off and go on either the self-medication or the post-coital pill. Some are not ready and they want to continue it a little bit longer, depending on what the reason is. Some women are on it for longer periods of time, especially if they're on chemotherapy, if they have an immunocompromised system, we might put them on that for longer. And that's a more close watch with those patients, because we have to sort of monitor where we are with them and when we're ready to get them off that program.
No, I think that's really great. The amount of options there, so you can introduce with intercourse and things like that. So do you have any tips for individuals who believe they've got recurrent UTIs and don't know where to turn next?
So the first thing is, these tend to come in clusters. So I think a lot of women feel that it's an escalating, it's like a linear issue. It goes from less bad to worse, worse, worse. And before you know it, you're like getting so many infections, you're going to wind up, in the hospital. But it doesn't work like that. You go through clusters, you have a series of infections 1 year, then you don't get as many the next year. And they go in clusters. And most of these, 99% of these, are harmless. These are not infections that are going to cause they're not going to get you in the hospital. But even the ones that get you very sick, once they resolve, you're completely healthy, your system recovers, your kidneys, your bladder, your whole body will recover. and you'll be back to your baseline. So there's a certain catastrophic feeling to this. And it the first thing is that it shouldn't be that way, that they're miserable when you get them, but they're not going to be like this for your whole life. And so I think it's really important for patients to know that. The second is that the better your health, the better your bladder, right? So good nutrition, good sleep, exercise, sexual activity keeps us healthy. That's what keeps us healthy and strong. So you want to do the best you can on that front. And then you find somebody, a provider who really cares about this condition and will treat you respectfully and effectively so that you have a way to deal with them. It's almost like you integrate them into your life. Mm-hmm. You accept that we don't know why they happen. We can't prevent them. We can manage them in a way that will make you a much more calm, happy, fulfilled person whose life is not being altered by this. And if you can find somebody who will help you do that, it will definitely make your life much easier.
Yeah, great. I think that's some really good points there. So finally, how can patients get in touch with you?
So we have a pretty robust website where you can contact us, ask questions. We do monitor it. We answer your questions. So through the website, they can go on, they can call. There's a phone number. But the best way is to email us or reach out to us on our website. And we welcome questions. We welcome patients. Anything that we can do to help, we want to do to help patients.
Well, thank you for chatting with us today about chronic and recurrent UTIs. I will include your information in the description below for those that are interested in learning more.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thanks so much for watching. I hope you found this video helpful. You're always welcome to reach out to us for more information about clinicians who specialise in recurrent and chronic UTIs. Our contact information is in the description. If you'd like to learn more about this or related topics, be sure to check out our other videos or head over to liveutifree.com for other articles on recurrent UTI treatment options. Of course, if you like what we're doing on this channel, make sure to hit the subscribe button here on YouTube and tick the bell so you get notifications about future videos. Thanks so much for joining us for our Clinician Insight series. If you have suggestions for who we should interview next, be sure to drop us a comment.